Hello everyone, I am Be Better Gamer. Welcome to Be Better Gamer Wrestling, your place for Let's Plays of WCW NW Revenge, Virtual Pro Wrestling 2, WWE 2K16, and WWF No Mercy, which is today's episode. Thank you for joining me. If this is your first time watching one of my Let's Plays, welcome. I hope you enjoy this video. I hope you watch it all the way through the end, or at least most of it. And I hope you check out my other videos on my other Let's Plays for all those other games as well. And if you are returning, if you are one of my subscribers, of the many supporters that I have, thank you so much. I appreciate you guys and gals coming and back to check out my videos. It really helps me a lot when you come back and check out my videos, not just subscribing, but actually, you know, keep viewing all the uploads and things I'm putting out there. It really helps my channel grow, and I'm very excited about how much it has grown. I am playing as the world's most dangerous man, Ken Shamrock, in WWF No Mercy. I am getting close to the end of my Intercontinental Championship path in No Mercy, and Ken Shamrock is actually a hidden character in No Mercy. He's not a hidden character in WrestleMania 2000. Another AKI, or I should say Aki, developed wrestling game. I have to break that bad habit of saying AKI, it's Aki. And I might even be pronouncing it wrong as well. But he was a hidden character in No Mercy, so the way you can unlock him, the easiest way is to unlock him in the SmackDown Mall by paying, I think, 50 Gs, I think, is to unlock him. Or you can eliminate him in survival mode. So in survival mode, every like 10 entrants, there's a hidden character. And I believe he's like in the 30s or something like that. I don't remember. I bought him in the SmackDown Mall this time around. It's just easier that way. But if you go through survival mode, and when he comes out in survival mode, if you eliminate him, then you can unlock him, as well as a lot of the other wrestlers who show up in there. You know, Shawn Michaels shows up in there, Mae Young. Well, she's not a hidden character. Jerry Lawler, all those people. So that's a fast way to unlock them if you don't want to spend the money. You also get some money from playing in survival mode, so that's kind of a benefit. But I paid for him, gave him his blue tights, edited his outfit a little bit, and won the Intercontinental Championship. This path I am doing, I have to win the first match, lose the second match, and win every other match. So pretty straightforward Let's Play for today. And why Ken Shamrock? So when I started my Intercontinental Championship path, I did it very differently than how I did my European and light heavyweight videos. I wanted to focus on the champions, the Intercontinental Champions, I should say, that held the title from, you know, like November of 99 to November of 2000. You know, if we're talking about when No Mercy came out, No Mercy came out in November 17th, 2000, and WrestleMania 2000 came out October 31st, 99, so right at the end of October. So if we're looking at November, it's safe to say that from November 99 to about November 2000, the game was being developed. They probably stopped development a month or two before November 2000 so that they can get it released and shipped. In a day and age without first day patches, you know, the game had to be ready, the game had to be done. They probably even started working on it sooner, but I wanted to focus on that year for my Let's Plays for the Intercontinental Championship path, because I wanted to go over who the Intercontinental champions were. There were a lot of new champions that year. Everyone who held the title that in that year period was a champion for the first time, with the exception of Val Venus. And then after that, after I finished going through all those characters, I still had a few spots left. So I decided to focus on some of the more memorable Intercontinental Champions. I did Shawn Michaels, I did The Rock, now I'm doing Ken Shamrock. Ken Shamrock only held the Intercontinental Championship one time. But it was a pretty significant and lengthy run. He held it one time, and it lasted well over 100 days. He actually ended up holding the title for 125 days. And that stood out to me because it's very rare that someone hold the championship in current day, you know, WWE, over 100 days. If you even look at the Intercontinental Championship, you know, right now Dean Ambrose is holding on to it as I record this episode. And, you know, he's had it for quite a while. He hasn't reached the 100-day mark yet. But after Shamrock, held the IC title, even back then, the next person that would hold the title more than 100 days would be Randy Orton in 2003. Shamrock got the title on October 12th, 1998. He won an Intercontinental Championship tournament. Triple H, who I talked about in my Rock Intercontinental Championship Let's Play video, Triple H, after beating The Rock at SummerSlam in that ladder match, he had to vacate the title a few months after because of a leg injury, a knee injury. And they held a tournament on Raw, and Shamrock won it. He won it in 98, and it wouldn't be until 2003 that someone held the title more than 100 days. Randy Orton's IC run was actually very long, 210 days. But after that, it was still very rare for someone to hold the title for more than 100 days. I am like trying so hard to have Dean Malenko reverse a Hurricanrana, and he's just not doing it. I'm like throwing all these Hurricanranas out and thinking he's gonna roll over because I'm trying to lose this match. So I'm throwing out strong grapples, and with a Hurricanrana with Dean Malenko, he can roll through, right, and counter it into a pin, and he's not doing that. It's like wasting time. It's like, come on, Dean, I want you to win this match. Can you please counter my Hurricanrana? Look at this. Look at this. Have you ever seen Ken Shamrock doing these many Hurricanranas in a match? He does a pretty cool Hurricanrana too. When Ken Shamrock started busting out the Hurricanranas, I was very impressed. I mean, this is a guy who comes from MMA, UFC, and I'm going to talk about that a little bit. But let me get back to the point I was trying to make. So that's why I was trying to focus on Ken Shamrock, because I felt like he was one of the last significant IC title holders before we got into, you know, the modern era of wrestling, or at least, you know, from post-Attitude era to, you know, what we have now, PG era, reality era, whatever you want to call it. I still don't know what we can call it yet. But, you know, Big E held the title for 167 days in 2013. Ryback held the title for 112 days in May of 2014. So it's still very rare. It's not an easy thing to do. You know, 100 days, you're looking at, that's a little bit more than 3 months. So 125 days, it seemed like the norm back then, because obviously you held the championships much longer. But now, like, holding a title, any title, for 100 days, you know, look online the past U.S. heavyweight champions and IC champions and even world champions, and you're going to see within the past 3 or 4 years, there hasn't been many people who have held the title more than 100 days. We all remember those people because they had very significant runs. So I think that's why I wanted to do Ken Shamrock, because I think a lot of people remember Ken Shamrock's time in WWE because it was very unique. And him holding the IC championship was part of that. So let's talk about that. Let's talk about Shamrock. Here comes Steve Blackman. Steve Blackman and Shamrock have a little bit of history in the WWE. But Shamrock comes from the world of MMA. You know, he rose to prominence back in the early 90s. You know, he had a rough childhood. If you guys listen to any podcasts, any wrestling podcast, I highly recommend. He did a podcast maybe about a year or so ago with Stone Cold Steve Austin, you know, Stone Cold's podcast. He did a two-parter, and he just went into such detail about his upbringing and his early life and how he got stabbed when he was like a kid and all the fights he would get into and his dealing with anger and aggression. Like, he legit, like, had a lot of anger and resentment, and a lot of it had to do with his upbringing and his dad, and his, you know, he was estranged from his dad, and his stepfather he didn't get along with, and all these things. Very rough, you know, poor living, you know, he ran away from home, living in cars, like, really messed up. I had no idea, you know, when he showed up in the WWE, I just thought he was just some superior, like, fighting athlete. I had no idea, like, this was a man from a very troubled home, and it's not something I realized until I listened to that podcast. So I highly recommend you listening to that podcast, because it was definitely an eye-opener, and it made me view Shamrock in a completely different way, because I finally got to know more about the man. A lot of that information probably was already out there, but I don't follow the world of MMA. I don't follow UFC. I think I mentioned this in my Virtual Pro Wrestling 2 Let's Play that I just recently did about Yoshiaki Fujiwara. you know, I just don't have the time. It's not like I don't like it. I just don't have the time to watch MMA. I gotta pick. I have to be very selective with my hobbies because of the lack of time I have. So my knowledge of MMA and UFC is very limited. I have a feeling it's gonna grow based off of these YouTube videos I'm doing because, you know, when I get a guy like Ken Shamrock who has competed in MMA and is a legend, you know, he has a UFC Hall of Famer and one of the early stars of UFC, and he participated in the origins of MMA in Japan because he trained at Fujiwara Gumi, which was a promotion started by Yoshiaki Fujiwara along with Masakatsu Funaki and Minoru Suzuki. Funaki and Suzuki broke off from Fujiwara Gumi and they created Pancrase, and Shamrock was part of that initial start of that promotion, and he fought as Wayne Shamrock, and Wayne I believe is his middle name, and he gained a lot of success and prestige there, especially because he beat Funaki on several occasions, and Funaki was one of the top MMA fighters in Japan at that time, as well as was Suzuki. So it was a big deal. He was the first King of Pancrase champion, so that solidified his legacy with the promotion. And this is the beginnings of MMA. You know, this Pancrase was one of the first promotions worldwide, you know, to do MMA. I remember when I was a kid and UFC first started coming about, it was very taboo. You know, it was very like, oh, what is this crazy sport where the guys like kill each other in this octagon? Like, it was very like, you know, you didn't talk about it, you couldn't watch it, it was too violent, and there was a lot of controversy. A lot of states, a lot of cities wouldn't give licenses for UFC matches in the beginning, or any MMA matches. They were very strict because they wanted to avoid the controversy. Much like with any new medium, there's always controversy. Video games, let's smash up the arcades, you know, mayors smashing up arcades and banning arcades, and some cities actually still have laws that are so outdated because of that still stand. Like, you know, anything, comics, movies, everything gets criticism in the beginning, and MMA was no different. Very violent sport, yeah, very violent sport, but, you know, it was still something that had to... even though it was popular right off the bat, people wanted to see, you know, these guys beat the crap out of each other. It had to get over that hill first. Now, UFC is on Fox. You know, it's so widely accepted. MMA is widely accepted everywhere in the country. But it took a long time to get there. And if you look back at the origins, Ken Shamrock was a part of that. You know, being with Pancrase, he joined UFC in 1993 as well. And he participated in the first UFC card, UFC 1. And they held a little tournament, and Shamrock got all the way to the end. And that's when he ran into Royce Gracie. And Royce Gracie, legendary MMA fighter. If you follow MMA, if you watch MMA, you probably know all about Royce Gracie and Gracie Jiu-Jitsu and everything like that. And all the other Gracies. Well, Ken Shamrock and Royce Gracie, that was the big rivalry back in the day. Because Ken Shamrock didn't really know who Royce Gracie was. You know, he's gone on record to say, I just thought it was some guy in a gi. And he underestimated him in that first match, and it drove him crazy. So he kept calling out Royce Gracie. The next time they were supposed to meet in the tournament, when it got to the end of the finals, this was Shamrock and Gracie again. Gracie backed out because of a knee injury, or so Shamrock says he claims. Shamrock called him out, said he was scared, he wasn't hurt, he didn't want to fight Shamrock. So they finally fought at UFC 3, I believe, and again, I'm going off of my research, so forgive me if I mess some of my information up. And they fought to a draw. It was supposed to be a no time limit. You know, a winner, it will only be declared if someone taps or gives, you know, gets knocked out. It can go for hours. Apparently, the rules were a lot more lax back then. They didn't really have rounds. You can fight for like an hour or two. And it was like, whatever, let them go until one of them chokes the other one out. But they changed the rules a little bit before the match. And they ended up going to a half-hour draw of an extra 5 minutes, I believe. And apparently there was no judges or anything like that. So Royce Gracie just was declared the winner. And Shamrock, that tore Shamrock up. And he wanted another match with Hoist Gracie. But Hoist Gracie left UFC. So Shamrock just continued to dominate the rest of the UFC heavyweight division. He would beat, he would start a rivalry with Dan Severn, beat Dan Severn and all these other guys. So Ken Shamrock was the first like star of UFC, one of the first stars, especially one of the first American stars, because again, MMA was very popular in Japan and a lot of other countries. Obviously Hoist Gracie, he's from Brazil, so very international, you know, which is really cool, which is something I feel like wrestling can learn from MMA. You know, we're gonna talk about a little bit with Ken Shamrock appearing in the WWE, and it's funny what Vince McMahon says about MMA these days, but you look at how MMA and a lot of other sports like boxing, you know, and a lot of other one-on-one sports, tennis even, there's such a emphasis on nationality, where someone's from, what country they represent, or what country they fight for. You know, this person's from Brazil, this fighter's from France, this fighter's from Japan, this fighter's from America. And there's such a nationalistic pride that comes from that representation. And wrestling, you know, early on in the 80s and even earlier than that, 70s, they always use nationality to say who's the good guy and who's the bad guy. Obviously, if you're in America, Americans are naturally going to always be the good guys if they're going up against, let's say, a Russian character. And now in wrestling, too, you have people, you know, it's performance. So you have guys playing a Russian guy. He's really from, you know, Jersey. You know what I mean? Like, they'll have, like, guys playing Italians, and they're really, you know, French, you know? So they do these things all the time. Japanese characters are always these exotic heel, wrestlers in America. Where on the flip side, you go to Japan, and foreign wrestlers, you know, non-Japanese wrestlers are usually automatically heel. You know, that was a big thing back in the day, and some of that still holds up today. They tend to do these tropes a lot with wrestling when it comes to nationality. I mean, look at today's product: Rusev, Sheamus, Alberto Del Rio. They're all heels. Okay, the League of Nations. Like, why is Rusev bad? Because he's Russian. You know, like there's no substance behind it. Whereas in a real sport, you can't say someone's bad because of where they're from, just because the promotion is based in America. You know, for instance, UFC, it's an American-based promotion. You can't say all the Russian MMA fighters, they're bad guys. Boo them. You know, because it's an international sport. It's trying to attract an international audience, and it wants you to be involved. If you see a fighter and he's Russian and you have a Russian nationality, you know, maybe you're American born, but your parents are Russian. Like, you can relate to that because you can relate to the culture and the heritage of being American Russian. And he's Russian. I'm going to root for him because we share that same bond of our nationalism. And I feel like that's something like this day and age, wrestling should try to finally do, to try to really embrace people's heritage and nationalism and where they're from. It's going to be very interesting what they do with someone like Kalisto, you know, instead of just blatantly just being like, oh, you know, he's the next Rey Mysterio, like really embrace the fact that he is wrestling the lucha style. He is Mexican-American. And really embrace that and have that sense of nationalism, but that doesn't, you know, pigeonhole him to being, you know, he has to be a babyface or he has to be a heel. You know what I mean? Like, don't always make it about race. Just let the race exist there so that fans can gravitate towards that. If they're not identifying with the character, then they can identify with the culture and the heritage. You know, look at the Samoans, Roman Reigns. I feel like, you know, that helps in a way. Because if you have fans who are Samoan, you know, I talked about it in the Rikishi Let's Play, you know, Rikishi and The Rock Let's Play. You know, The Rock fought Rikishi at WrestleMania, and they kept hyping up The Rock's heritage, him being a third generation wrestler. But they didn't talk about Rikishi because he's supposed to be playing the Sultan, and you're not supposed to know his real identity. And it's such a shame because it's like these are two Samoans you know, fighting on WrestleMania, it should be a big deal. It should make it more big deal about that. So that's a big tangent having to do with the nationalism. But, you know, I'm gonna talk a bit about MMA in this, because Ken Shamrock, he was the bridge between two worlds. And for me, being very young, that's what kind of opened my eyes a little bit to UFC, to MMA. I heard all this buzz about UFC, didn't quite get it. And then when Shamrock showed up in the WWE and they kept hyping him up, it's like, oh, that's what UFC is. Oh, this is very violent. You know, the whole thing, it's more real than wrestling. I'm not going to get into that. But, you know, it was something that created that debate. Can wrestlers go off into UFC and make something of themselves? Can UFC people go into WWE and make something of themselves? That's something that started way back with Ken Shamrock, and that's something we still talk about now. When you had Brock Lesnar go into UFC, when you had Batista try out MMA, and even now CM Punk going into UFC. So it's always existed. It's not a new thing, which is crazy that we're coming back around to it. And Ken Shamrock was that first bridge. He was that first gap. And again, obviously, wrestling has always been associated with MMA in some form, because a lot of the groundwork of what started a lot of the big MMA promotions started in Japan, because they were spin-offs from the already existing strong style shoot wrestling. I talk about that also in some detail in my Yoshiaki Fujiwara Virtual Pro Wrestling 2 Let's Play, so go check that out. So yeah, so Shamrock shows up in WWE. He shows up as a special guest referee in the very famous Austin Hart WrestleMania 13 match. I say very famous because honestly, if you're a wrestling fan and you don't know about that match, go do your homework, watch that match. Still holds up to this day. Great match. Double heel turn. Bret Hart, you know, turns heel after that match. Stone Cold turns babyface after that match. Jumpstarts Stone Cold Steve Austin's career. Jumpstarts Bret Hart's turn as a heel, which was a great heel turn, which is, I think, a very underrated heel turn, honestly. And he did some of his best mic work as a heel when he turned. And that would send Bret Hart down the path where eventually you get to the screw job and all that stuff. And it would send Austin down the path to being Stone Cold Steve Austin and going against McMahon and the corporation. And Shamrock was there. Shamrock was there as the beginning, and that's significant too, because he was the special guest referee, brought in to, like, you know, make sure nothing goes wrong. And after that, he started wrestling for WWE. He made his in-ring debut on an episode of Raw on April 7th, 1997, so about a month after WrestleMania, in a worked shoot fight against Vernon White. I say worked shoot fight because, you know, WWE advertised it as an exhibition match shoot fight, but, you know, it was in the WWE. It was obviously worked. Ken Shamrock beat Vernon White. Vernon White was actually a student of Shamrock's, and he competed a bunch in Pancrase, and would actually, from what I read, didn't read too much on Vernon, but he would become a very pretty successful MMA fighter himself. So that's good for Vernon. he didn't just get stomped on by Shamrock in his debut. But it's interesting to know that was his student, so maybe that's how he got the gig. After that, Vader came out, and that would be Shamrock's first big feud against Vader. And they would have a very stiff match at In Your House 15, Cold Day in Hell. Once again, I go through the pay-per-views when I do these Let's Plays because I like to give people reference so that they could go on, like, the WWE Network and, you know, watch these matches. Again, if you don't have the WWE Network, what are you waiting for? And what was crazy about Shamrock's debut, if you go back, he was very well protected. Again, this is a guy who legitimately was a badass. You know, they called him the world's strongest man. That came from like an ABC episode World Dangerous Man. That came from an ABC series where they would talk about the world's most dangerous world's most dangerous food, the world's most dangerous jobs, the world's most dangerous, you know, people. And Ken Shamrock was the subject of the world's most dangerous man because, again, he was one of the most popular UFC fighters, and UFC was beginning to rise. MMA was beginning to rise in America. So they talked about this, a guy who was going in and trying to, like, kill other people in the octagon like that. That's how they presented MMA to the public at the time, that these guys are trying to kill each other. Ooh, they're going to kill each other. And here I go making the run-in, Dean Malenko. Running matches are always kind of fun. They're pretty easy because it just becomes like a glorified handicap match. So they're pretty easy to win. I've got to say, this is a pretty easy Intercontinental Championship path. You know, I try to end a lot of the singles matches with my ankle lock submission hold, except for the handicap matches and the tag team matches. Obviously, those are harder to win with an ankle lock, but Shamrock's got that nice, perfect plex. You know, fisherman suplex pin to combat that, those situations where I can't just keep working on the guy's legs the whole time because of like a handicap or a tag team. So yeah, so he was brought in and started feuding with Vader, beat Vader, and he was very well protected. He never lost a match clean for like a good year and a half, almost. Like, all his losses came from DQs or countouts. And even then, even when he did started losing clean, it was always by, like, the top guys. Like, Austin beat him, you know, one time. Taker beat him clean. You know, he lost to the really big guys. But they really did a great job of protecting Shamrock because that's an iffy place you get to. I mean, you know, you got this guy who, in the viewer's eyes, you're building him up. You're like, hey, he's from UFC. He's a big deal. He beats people up for real, okay? And, you know, this is wrestling. You know, we let guys know who's going to win. So you're already telling your audience, no, he's legit. He's a legitimate person. But now he's got to play the game, and we're still going to book him to win or lose our way. So how do we do that? You know, it was a very interesting thing to watch unfold, and to watch him in these big high profile matches. When I went back and watched, I was like, oh, he fought The Rock. Oh, that's how they did that win. That's how they did that victory. I talked about it in my Rock Let's Play, but that was, you know, one of his other big early feuds, Ken Shamrock versus The Rock. This is when The Rock was rising, you know, with the Nation, calling himself The Rock, and they would feud over The Rock's Intercontinental Championship. That would be Ken Shamrock's first chase over the Intercontinental Championship, would be against The Rock. They fought at Royal Rumble 98. You know, The Rock won because of DQ. Very great DQ, by the way. Love that DQ. Rock had some brass knuckles thrown to him. He hits Shamrock with the brass knuckles, then puts the brass knuckles into Shamrock's tights, goes for the pin. Shamrock still manages to kick out because he's Shamrock. And then when the ref's not looking, the Rock is you know, and when Shamrock gets the pin on the Rock, the Rock is like, you know, showing that he's like, oh, he hit me with something. And the ref checks Shamrock's tights, and he finds the brass knuckles. Such a great trick, such a heel move. I love it. It's so cool. But actually, that, you know, Shamrock thought he got the IC title. Decision got reversed. This was set up WrestleMania 14, The Rock against Ken Shamrock again, and Ken Shamrock would beat him. He would make The Rock tap, okay, with the ankle lock, but he wouldn't let go of The Rock. And this is when Shamrock was really embracing that world's most dangerous man, when he was snapping. You saw bits and pieces of it when he first showed up, and they kept, you know, he's dangerous, you never know what he's gonna do. But he was a babyface, so like, he didn't really go too far, too crazy. But this is when he started really going over the edge, where he just started seeing red and would just scream and yell all the time. Very entertaining stuff. I mean, he looked crazy. He looked like a guy. He looked like the world's most dangerous man. I think that was the most compelling thing about Ken Shamrock, early Ken Shamrock. And he wouldn't let go of The Rock and the ankle lock, so the ref actually reversed the decision, saying, no, I'm stripping you of the IC title, giving it back to The Rock. So technically, Shamrock won the IC title twice off of The Rock. Both times the decision was reversed. Really cool stuff. But he would get his victory over The Rock at King of the Ring 98. defeating The Rock in the King of the Ring finals. And that's when Ken Shamrock would start transitioning more to a heel character. A couple of months after that, he would start becoming more heel. And in October is when he would win the IC title in the tournament. Shortly after the tournament, Shamrock would join the corporation. So that's when you saw Shamrock rolling with Boss Man a lot, doing the bidding of the corporation. Vince McMahon, obviously, you know, leader of the corporation. The Rock and Shamrock would meet once again at Survivor Series in yet another tournament, Survivor Series 98. This was the Deadly Games tournament. Shamrock's already IC champion by this point, but whoever won that tournament would win the World Heavyweight Championship, which Vince McMahon stripped Stone Cold Steve Austin of. And I uploaded a bunch of videos from WrestleMania 2000, historic matches, if you will, of the Survivor Series tournament where I played as Ken Shamrock in WrestleMania 2000. So that's kind of neat. You get to see Ken Shamrock in WrestleMania 2000, and now you get to see Ken Shamrock in No Mercy. Here's Kurt Angle, and people have been talking about that there's going to be a Kurt Angle, Ken Shamrock, maybe even shoot match in the next couple of years. Ken Shamrock is like 50 years old today. All right, he's up there, and he's actually fighting Hoist Gracie in a couple of weeks as I record this in a MMA match. And it's just nuts. It's like, why are they letting these guys fight each other? But there's rumors, there's rumblings that Kurt Angle wants to do an MMA match. Kurt Angle's no spring chicken, but you know, they're both machines. Kurt Angle and Ken Shamrock, they're cut from the same cloth. They're machines, man. And so we might see a Ken Shamrock Kurt Angle match. But man, just think about if Ken Shamrock stayed in the WWE. So after he won the King of the Ring, you know, he won the IC Championship, and then like he just, you know, he was just beating people up, winning matches. His feuds weren't ever really up there. They weren't ever really high profile. You know, he dabbled with like the big names. You know, he had that World Championship match with Shawn Michaels one time. He fought Stone Cold Steve Austin one time. He fought The Undertaker. You know, when he turned, he was with the corporation. He got the Tag Team Championship during the time he was the IC Champion. You know, he beat Mankind at Judgment Day. He beat Goldust. He feuded with Steve Blackman. He always was like mid, upper mid card, but he never really went into that main event scene. Ken Shamrock actually talks about, I think he talks about it in Jim Ross's podcast, because he also did a podcast episode with Jim Ross. He did talk about that. He feels that, he didn't find out until he left WWE, because he left WWE to go back to MMA. He wanted to do MMA again. So his run in WWE was very short. He was in WWE from 97 to 99. Okay? Very short run. 3 years. 3 years. But I feel like he left a big impact in those 3 years. And a lot of people still remember Ken Shamrock. Ken Shamrock was even in WWE 2K16. Obviously, they got to put him in there because of the whole Austin showcase, Austin Bret Hart. You got the referee, so that's why they put him in there. But he was in WWE 2K16. He was also in WWE 13 when they did the whole Attitude Era. So Ken Shamrock is definitely representative of the Attitude Era because he brought some legitimacy to WWE. Which is very ironic because recently Vince McMahon has stated that he doesn't see UFC as competition to the WWE. He thinks that the UFC is barbaric and, you know, he doesn't agree with the tone and tempo of UFC. Go and watch Ken Shamrock's debut in the WWE. Go and watch that WrestleMania match. And here, when he's coming to the ring, here are the words that Vince McMahon is saying. And he's praising the Ken Shamrock as being this glorious fighter from MMA, from UFC, even name-dropping UFC, even promoting their upcoming UFC card. Okay? And he's like talking about how great it is to have an athlete of that caliber in the WWE. And how they're able to use Brock Lesnar these days as a legitimate, you know, champion and fighter, which is something, you know, they couldn't do before he went to MMA. Obviously, he had his collegiate wrestling background, and he was just, you know, a genetic freak But it wasn't until he went to MMA, did his thing, and came back to the WWE that they really started pushing him as this legitimate, unstoppable force. And if you look at the way he's booked now, it's very reminiscent of how they booked Ken Shamrock. Because what do you do with this guy who everyone knows can probably legitimately beat up half the roster? You know what I mean? And not just like physically beat up, not just like punch a guy in the face and he knocks him out. Like, you know, there is skill, there is technique, submissions and holds and grappling and wrestling. Like, a lot of guys can't do that on the roster because they weren't trained in that. So when you go up against someone who was trained in that for many, many years and fought at a very high level, chances are you probably won't do well against them. And so that's what they do now with Brock Lesnar. That's what they did with Ken Shamrock. And it's very interesting to see that. I love ending Let's Plays, or not Let's Plays, but Championship Paths with a four-way dance. Four-way dance is my favorite match type in WWF No Mercy, Virtual Pro Wrestling 2, WCW Enderby Revenge. I just love it. Just love four-way dances. Elimination. Great. So much fun. So, you know, Shamrock, when he would lose the title, he would lose the IC title finally to Val Venus at St. Valentine's Day Massacre. After that, he didn't do much of anything. His last match was actually against Chris Jericho on an episode of SmackDown where they fought in a First Blood match, and Jericho came out with, you know, with the hockey gear and everything like that. It was very funny, but it would have been interesting to see, because you look at, I mean, look who we're in the ring with right now. We got Jericho, Malenko, Kurt Angle. You know, right at the turn of 2000, Jericho started getting really hot. You had the Radicals come in. Kurt Angle, within a year, he would have the best rookie year of any wrestler ever. And I've talked about that in my Intercontinental Championship Let's Play with Kurt Angle. Imagine if Shamrock stayed. If he stayed in WWE, you know, his legacy, his return to MMA wasn't as glorious as it was when he first competed in the 90s. You know, he did pretty well when he first came back, but then after a few years, you know, age caught up to him. It's the same reason why Brock Lesnar went back to the WWE. After a while, your age catches up to you, your body catches up to you, and I'm not saying that wrestling is easy. It's not easy by any means, but I can guarantee that as an athlete, in an environment in wrestling where it is entertainment, where you are telling a story rather than actually trying to beat a guy on the highest level, your body is gonna probably love you more for that. Not saying that your body doesn't still take a ton of punishment in WWE, because it definitely does, but if you're not going up against a guy who's trying to kill you and, you know, who's really trying to hurt you and injure you, you know, what option are you going to take? Obviously, you're going to take, you know, the wrestling option, WWE, because it's storytelling, it's art, it's performance, it's entertainment, all those things. It's not competitive, because, I mean, I'm sure it's competitive for them backstage. You know, they want to all be on the top of the card, so they all are competitive within themselves, but it's not an actual competitive sport. You know, the matches are predetermined, so it's easier on the body in a way, because you're not having to train on like the highest level, because some of the guy might try to kill you the next time you fight. That's why Brock Lesnar most likely came back, especially having to deal with his diverticulitis and all those injuries. Ken Shamrock went the opposite route. Ken Shamrock went back to MMA despite all his injuries, despite his age, and even now to this day, many people are calling him stubborn. You know, he's still wanting to compete at the highest level, and like when you're 50, like, honestly, you can't compete at the highest level. Just naturally, like, Father Time catches up to us all. So it would have been really interesting to see if he stayed, because he was still a very great worker in the ring. You know, Ken Shamrock, watching early Ken Shamrock, and again, he only was in the WWE for a few years. Imagine if he was able to stay just 2-3 more years. He would have gotten to work with Benoit. He would have gotten to work with Kurt Angle. He would have gotten to work with Jericho. He probably would have learned a little bit more about the performance. He would have grown more as a character, grown more as a pro wrestler. I mean, again, a lot of his early training came from a pro wrestling background, obviously, because he worked with guys who came from a pro wrestling, but they were more focused on the shoot style wrestling, you know, and they went, they formed Pancrase and did actual shoot matches, you know, and so Ken Shamrock's true knowledge came from that, which is why he thrived in UFC. But imagine if he stayed in WWE right around the time when WWE was getting hot. You know, he talked about in the podcast with Jim Ross, I don't think I finished this thought because I got distracted with the game, but he talked about in the podcast with Jim Ross that after he had left, he had found out that he was gonna be in line eventually for a World Heavyweight Championship run, but that didn't happen sooner because of a lot of the backstage, you know, click, if you will, Shawn Michaels, Triple H, all those guys, preventing that from happening probably much earlier than it should have. So that's why he got into that weird middle card range, even though this guy was legit one of the toughest competitors in the WWE at the time. And most realistic, I mean, you could have him both ways. You could have him be a realistic babyface, because when he broke off from the corporation and went after the ministry, he went back to being a babyface. But even you can have him as a heel, as this guy who just can't beat the ring. And he could have been that. But if, imagine, like, to see him work in matches with Kurt Angle in his prime. Like, I don't want to see Kurt Angle and Shamrock now, today. Like, I love the guys. I respect both of them and what they've done. But honestly, like, to see, you know, Shamrock, Benoit, Kurt Angle, Malenko, Jericho, Saturn even. Oh man, like all those guys. And to see, you know, Shamrock, you could have revisited Shamrock and The Rock when The Rock was really getting into his groove. Because, you know, I talked about it in The Rock's Intercontinental Championship Let's Play. You know, Rock, Triple H, it seemed like they were kind of joined at the hip at the beginning. And both of them were really in the early stages of their personas that would define them, would define their legacy with WWE. So that's why, flash forward a couple of years later, after their SummerSlam match, the ladder match between The Rock and Triple H, you got these classic memorable matches. You got that Iron Man match with The Rock and Triple H and all these things. You got the, you know, Austin Rock 2. You know, these guys were coming into their own. If Shamrock would have stayed, the whole landscape would have been different. Imagine if Brock Lesnar came into the WWE with Shamrock at the height of his popularity in WWE. You know what I mean? Like, so many things would have been different. It would have been nuts. It would have been nuts to see. And, you know, unfortunately, we can't go on a time machine and try to change history. So we'll just have to play these games. And you know, imagine him. I do want to talk about, you know, WWF No Mercy doesn't have a very extended Legends division in this game, or so hidden characters. And it's interesting that they put Ken Shamrock as a hidden character. I wonder they did that because, again, he left WWE around, like, what was it, mid-99? No, not mid-99, because Jericho's around late 99. Late 99, he left WWE. And again, No Mercy was released at the end of 2000, like November 2000. So Shamrock was already gone before the year 2000. So while WrestleMania 2000 had wrapped up, you had Shamrock in that game. Makes you wonder how they were able to keep him with the licensing and all that stuff, keep him as a hidden character. You know, they got Andre the Giant as a hidden character, Shawn Michaels, hidden character, but like, they don't really have a lot of other WWE legends as hidden characters, maybe because a lot of those legends were in WCW at the time. But it's interesting to see that Shamrock was kept in there. I guess because this game really does revolve a lot around the Attitude Era. But I'm glad he's still in here because I like playing as Shamrock. I think he has a good moveset. And I always think about what could have been. I really do think Shamrock is very underrated in his impact with the Attitude Era. I think a lot of people remember Shamrock being the Attitude Era. And if you look at what has happened now to where we are today and what has become of MMA, it's even more, you know, interesting and enlightening to see how all that started so long ago in the late 90s with WWE, with Ken Shamrock, and now how we have today with UFC on Fox, with MMA being popular around the world, with Shamrock still competing in MMA, but you know, Brock Lesnar, CM Punk going to UFC. It's just, it's so interesting how it all works out. And it makes you wonder, you know, how things could have been different. But anyway, that's my Let's Play for Ken Shamrock. I hope you enjoyed this video. I enjoyed it talking about, you know, the world outside of wrestling. You know, with my virtual pro wrestling too, there's a lot of MMA fighters in there. I didn't even get to talk about that. But Minoru Suzuki, Masakatsu Funaki, they're in that game. So I'll definitely do more MMA talk with my virtual pro wrestling too. Let's plays down the line. Until then, why don't you give this video a like, comment, subscribe. Let me know what you think about Ken Shamrock, a what if scenario if he had stayed. And yeah, thank you. Thank you for watching this video. Until next time. You know, watch some other stuff on my channel, but keep watching wrestling and watch some MMA while you're at it. Alrighty, thank you everyone. Take care.